podcast is brought to you by the Pro Football Central Radio Network. Time now for Patriots Central Radio with Steve Ballistrie and Russ Goldman and Thomas Murphy.
And welcome back to Patriots Central Radio. I'm your host tonight, Steve Ballistrieri. Joining me, as always, is Thomas Murphy, the Big Green Man, and Russ Goldman. And we have a fantastic show for you guys tonight. We're going to be talking about the Patriots preseason up to this point. We're going to talk a little bit about training camp, how training camp's been going, if the joint practices with the Washington Redskins. And joining us in 30 minutes is going to be Field Yates, national writer, celebrity, I guess you could say, from ESPN Insiders. Field is everywhere lately on the TV, on the radio, so we're really looking forward to picking his brain for a few minutes, and it should be a lot of fun. But before we get going, I want to say hello to my co-host, Murph. How are you doing this evening?
I'm great, Steve. Happy to be here. Hope to help the ball club.
How's Butchie doing?
He's great. He's bored to tears. His season's over, and now he's marking off days to get back to school, because when he goes back to school, fall ball season starts.
That's a baseball man at heart. Yep. Russ, how are you doing this evening, my friend?
I'm doing great, Steve. Now that I finished my dinner, I'm doing really good.
His pulled chicken from Trader Joe's, right? Am I correct?
You are correct.
I could smell it right through the radio waves here, man. That's awesome. And Russ, last week we talked briefly on the air about what you've been doing. You went down to Fulham, and you went down to Jacksonville, I should say, to see the Fulham soccer club play the what do they call it, a friendly down there at Jacksonville.
Right.
But you also got to spend a little time with the owner of the Jacksonville Jaguars. So fill our listeners in a little bit about that.
Sure. Yeah, I had about 10 minutes to talk to Shai Khan, the owner of Fulham Football Club and the Jacksonville Jaguars. And we had a really interesting conversation, because he actually compared how Fulham are dealing with their transition to what is going on with the Jaguars. Basically, Fulham about a year behind his timetable for the Jaguars, and we talked a little bit about, you know, how really they're getting things going now. They are heading in the right direction, and I know people up here don't really believe it in the Jaguars, but I'm here to tell you that if they get the quarterback right, they have a chance to do something in the next couple of years.
That's awesome.
Sure, and London's thrilled.
What a thrill to talk to the owner of the Jags. I mean, come on, you know. I wish we could have that luxury here in New England, but I know that snowballs will freeze in hell before we get a chance to do that. So.
Right.
Anyway, let's talk about some of these joint practices that's been going on. Last week we touched a little bit, you know, on training camp, but these joint practices with the Redskins, a couple of things we looked for have come to fruition. We understand Brady was very sharp, and a couple of things we talked about, we wanted to see the wide receivers other than, you know, Julian Edelman step up. And from all reports, Danny Amendola and Brandon LaFell were having some good practices down there with the team against the Redskins. So I want to touch on Brady, and I want to get you guys' thoughts on that. Amendola, Brandon LaFell, and of course Edelman, they said, was very sharp as well again. So Murph, I'll go to you first.
Well, you know, it all comes down to how you want to read into the propaganda. We're talking about practice, guys, and everybody looks great in practice. Nobody's playing at full speed. It's comes down to who you want to believe. I mean, if you read the reports out of the Patriot camp, everything was sunshine and daisies and long passes down the field. And if you take a look at what what most of the writers and bloggers down in Washington were talking about, the Pats looked better, but it wasn't as rosy a picture as was painted by some of our friends up here in the Northeast.
Yeah, which is, I find that intriguing, because usually those are the guys that are kind of like, the cold, wet blanket, when mm-hmm. it comes to the Patriots. They can win 48-7, and, when you read the reports, you think they lost by that much, which I found interesting, because usually, the Patriots beat writers tend to err on the side of caution by a long shot. And this time they were kind of effusive in their praise, which I found interesting, of all the players. And they kind of talked down a little bit about the Redskins, whereas the Redskins beat writers were kind of taking a middle of the road view. I'm not going to say they think the Redskins got the better of the practices, because they didn't say that at all, but they were a little bit more reserved in their judgments. Russ, how do you feel about this one?
Well, this is how I feel, Steve. First of all, I like to judge by what I see and what we've seen. Me, you, and a co-host on another show had been at every single practice except for the in-stadium practice, and I like to judge by what the three of us have seen. So when I hear all these reports, and Murph is very, very good to bring up what the Washington people are saying, because it is different than what they're saying in the Boston media. So again, I'm looking forward to the game. I'm kind of not reading too much into it, because if you remember last year, the Patriots opened up against Philadelphia with the joint practices, and guess what? They had a rookie coach there too. So I think it's a difficult transition for Washington to go against the Patriots when you are going against, I guess you could say, a rookie coach. So of course the Patriots are going to be ahead of Washington. I think that's a natural. That's why I'm trying not to read too much into it. I will read a little bit more into tomorrow, because again, like Murph was saying, it's live hitting. It's, again, there is hitting in these practices, but it's actually a game scenario. So to answer your question, Steve, I'm really not reading much into what happened this week?
Yeah, it's interesting, because, like we said, we were there for the joint practices against Tampa Bay last year. And, on the first day of those practices, I thought Tampa Bay definitely had the better of the Patriots, especially on the Tampa Bay offense. We saw time after time with Vincent Jackson just, torching Patriots secondary. He was torturing them all day long. The second day was a lot less of that, and then by the time the game came around, the Patriots kind of dominated them, and then they did it again in the regular season. But it is interesting, and we had Andy Hart on last week, and he had some good comments. I was reading his column from down there, and one of the things he mentioned that I was not even aware of was Josh Boyce and RG3 went to high school together. They were on the same high school team, and that in between drills, they were, catching up. And the only thing I can say, that must have been one heck of a high school football team.
Right.
But I thought that was pretty cool. I mean, I like the things I was hearing out of there, because, one of the things we talked about are these wide receivers like Danny Amendola, Brandon LaFell, Boyce to a lesser degree. Were they struggling because they're just struggling, or were they struggling because of Revis and Browner? And then we're hearing, the past couple of days that they were having good days down there. They were making plays on the ball, and that's all you want, I think, out of preseason. But the one thing I will talk about was Mike Reese in his column, I think it was yesterday, talked about how the one-on-one battles he thought the Redskins did a really much better job than the Patriots along both the offensive and defensive lines. Pass protection, you know, the guys when they were going one-on-one, which I found very interesting. And that could make its, you know, presence felt tomorrow night, because where you have more of these vanilla-type game plans, you know, coaches want to see that one-on-one, you know, matchups. And according to Mike Reese, and I want to get your feelings on this one, Merv, he said he thought the Redskins got the better of him.
Well, you can always count on Mike for an honest opinion, you know, and it's early. There are guys that aren't fully integrated. There's a lot of guys that are new and just working their way back into things, you know, coming off of injuries. So, yeah, no, I can understand why Mike would see things that way, and I can see why it would pan out that way.
Yeah. Russ, what's your feeling on this? Did you happen to read Mike's column about the you know, the pass protection and the for both teams on that?
I didn't, Steve, but, you know, it's funny. You were talking about this, and you're also talking about last year when you and I got to see the Patriots go up against Tampa, and how, say, one day Tampa looked good and the next day that the Patriots looked good. And then you went to see the actual game, Steve, and if I remember correctly, the Patriots basically dominated. So it's tough. I'm glad that he's being honest and saying that that he believes that the that Washington did better in these one-on-one battles. I think that's, you know, I want someone to be honest with me, but ultimately it's difficult because there's so much spin going on. Again, if you listen to Mike Mayock, Ryan Mallett is going to be in the Hall of Fame someday, you know. So again, it's difficult to read too much. I'm taking it a little bit too far there, but he had nothing but praise about Ryan Mallett, and then you see the Patriots media, and they're completely different on the same practice. So
exactly, and that's what I wanted to segue into this, because I was really surprised at Mike Mayock's comments, because Mike was, again, effusive in his praise about Ryan Mallett, the way he ran the offense and how he's ready to take over a team and this. And I wanted to get your guys' take on this, because then again, you read Andy Hart, you read Mike Reese, and they said Mallett had one of his worst practices in training camp, they thought, on Monday. So I thought that was really interesting that Mike Mayock just loved what he saw out there, and yet the beat writers didn't think so. And is this a case of Mayock being a Belichick friend and maybe trying to pump the tires a little bit on Ryan Mallett for some trade value there, or did he just see something that the other guys did? Russ, I'll go right back to you.
Oh, I totally think that this is a Belichick thing. I mean, listen, I could be wrong. You know how I feel about Ryan Mallett. I would actually fly down to Richmond, Virginia, pick him up and take him to any other city that the Patriots trade him to right now. I mean, that should tell you how I feel about Ryan Mallett playing for the New England Patriots any further, because he's just not good enough. And if Mike Mayock was doing Bill Belichick a solid and trying to get his trade value up, I'm all for that. I just listened to a discussion on this with Albert Breer, and Albert Breer has now said this again. I've heard him say it twice, that he believes the Patriots are going to try to shop Mallett over the preseason and then maybe at the trade deadline. So I actually, you know, again, I get where Albert Breer's going on that, because, again, he's not going to be the starting quarterback for the New England Patriots anytime soon. And you and I have talked, Steve. I would be all for getting rid of Ryan Mallett and taking my chances with Jimmy Garoppolo as my backup, because Brady gets hurt. They're not going anywhere anyway. So those have been my thoughts. I haven't changed them.
Okay, Murph. Let's get your take on this.
Well, I don't want to echo what Russ is saying, but, you know, sometimes you have to wonder where who's cashing, who's writing the checks for these guys at the NFL Network? Is it Bill Belichick or is it the actual NFL Network? This is old boy stuff. You know, let's take care of our friends and see if we can help them out. And that's what's happening. The Pats want to trade, Mallett. They want to trade him almost as bad as Russ does. That's why they brought in Colt McCoy this week for a look. Because they're hoping to move Mallett and then still bring in somebody that might have the brain power to step in for a couple of games if Tom goes down. Because I also think that they're coming to the realization that the second round pick that they spent was not spent well.
I think it's way too early for that assessment. And with Garoppolo,
well, meaning that if something they can't trade Mallett without having somebody else because they know that Garoppolo can't step in this season and do anything. That's the point I'm making. Not that a bust of a pick.
Yeah, because you know, I think Garoppolo, we expected him to struggle in his rookie training camp, and you know he's having some issues, but. You know, I'm anxious to see, and we'll talk about this later, how he steps in, you know, when he gets a chance to play, because I believe him and Mallett will play a lot, you know, tomorrow night. But we're going to take a real short break, and when we come back, we're going to flip it over and talk about the defensive side of the ball and how things went against the Redskins.
Football fans, check out ProFootballCentral.com for all the latest NFL news and analysis. Also, check out the very popular Pro Football Central radio network for awesome NFL talk around the league. Go to ProFootballCentral.com. ProFootballCentral.com.
All right, on the defensive side of the ball. Now, again, you know, the difference between the normally, you know, I'm not going to say negative, but, you know, they're glass half empty kind of media guys in New England. They were pretty heavy on the praise with the Patriots defense. Now, they, you know, Andy Hart, again, I'll go back to Andy because we had him on. You know, he said RG3 struggled for the most part, but then he made some nice plays. And they actually caught a couple of balls over Revis's head, you know, which is interesting because we haven't seen too much of that in Foxborough yet. But overall, they thought that the Patriots' pass rush was giving RG3 some problems. Is this something... You know, is this something, guys, that, you know, I'll go back to you first, Murph. Is this something we're going to see more of, do you think? Or, you know, are they going to be very vanilla here in the preseason?
In the preseason, probably. They're not going to want to show their hand too much, especially this first week. But it's great news, isn't it, that, you know, they had – we talked before about the opinions – coming from up north and what's happening down there in D.C., but everybody was in a consensus that the defense looked really tough and that Griffin had some seriously happy feet and big eyes while he was dropping back in the pocket. They seen the Pats routinely from everybody I've talked to and everything I heard were collapsing the pocket around him, and I'm loving that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, they did. And, you know, we heard good things about, you know, Will Smith, Vince Wilfork. Yep. Wilfork actually intercepted a screen pass. And, you know, we had Shades of San Diego from a couple of years ago.
Rumble, young man Rumble.
I was there for that game. That was interesting
great?
To see. And you should have heard the stadium.
The things I like is that Revis supposedly looked great against DeSean Jackson, but what I didn't like was the fact that somebody that we all applauded coming here was more on the Brandon Browner front, And from what I'm reading and talking to people about, he was holding a lot while he was down there. It wasn't mugging somebody, you know, inside, you know, the 5 yards, but you know, flags would have been flying. And that I don't like. I understand he's coming in here and he's trying to make an impression and show that Seattle made a mistake in letting him walk. But, you know, when you're holding on every other play, you know, you need to get quicker.
Yeah, you know, and that's something Mike Reese talked about as well, that he said that the you know, the Redskins receivers were complaining about Brandon Browner a lot, that he was mugging guys, that he was holding them, that he was hitting them, you know, past the 5 yards and all this. But, you know, that's his game. And he's going to push the envelope, I believe, right to the limit, and then we'll see, you know, who gets the calls on this. And, you know, those first four games that he's going to miss, I think that's where the officials are going to find their happy medium, how they're going to call things. So, you know, he's going to miss those four games probably at a good time. So, Russ, let me get your feelings on this as well.
Well, Steve, to be honest with you, I've wanted an aggressive defense for the longest time. You and I have talked about this. And I think what you're going to see, what you're seeing there, again, I'm trying not to read too much into this because, again, it's joint practices, but everything that I've heard and everything that Murph also reiterated is that that the Patriots' pass rush has been very good this, you know, these last couple days. And I think part of that is going to come down to the Revis and Browner effect, and I think that's going to pay dividends this season. We talk a great deal, Steve, about the lack of pass rush. Something tells me you're not going to be hearing about that as much this season, and it's going to be because of the secondary, because one helps the other. If they can hold longer back there, the pass rush is going to get there. I got a funny feeling we're just not going to hear about the lack of pass rush this year.
Yeah, that's a good point. Hopefully we won't hear much about that. You know, it's funny about Brandon Browner, because like some of the receivers were talking about that, but then Gruden, who's an offensive coach, you know, he was pointing out after the fact that he didn't have any issue with it. He thought it was just a great experience for his team, you know, to work against physical corners like that, because that's how they're going to have to make their living, is getting off that, you know, the jam at the line of scrimmage. But, you know, Revis and DeSean Jackson had some good, you know, battles out there, and both of them spoke well of each other. So this is something that, you know, we've seen in the beginning of training camp that I'm really looking forward to seeing more of once they get going. But, you know, this thing with the defense is just intriguing, because they still don't have their number one draft pick in there, and that Dominique Easley, and he's supposed to be the disruptor. So if they're doing well with the guys, especially the guys who've been hurt, and, you know, you have Vince Wilfork, who was stepping up, you know, just about everyone, even the Redskins writers were raving about Vince, about how he was just clogging up the middle. He intercepted that one screen pass. Tommy Kelly's getting healthy. He was stepping up. And one of the things I like is they've been moving Will Smith and Zach Moore inside in certain pass situations. And both of them are pretty big dudes.
Right.
You know, they're almost the size of Easley. You know, Will Smith is 6'3", 282. And Easley, I think, what is Easley? He's like 6'2", 288, so pretty similar in size. Zach Moore is a different, you know, he's a big, tall, lanky kid, and he's still kind of raw, but I like seeing them giving him some shots in there. He's like 285 as well, you know. So, you know, I love the fact that they're experimenting with this pass rush, and, you know, things are looking good for them with this. So, and I want to get your guys' thoughts on this. Who are you guys worried about so far not stepping up on the defensive side? And Russ, I'll go right back to you on that.
Wow, that's a great question, Steve. I really have to think about it because you and I have talked. A position that really has, and I guess you could say solidified itself, has been the safety position to go along with Devin McCourty. So I've liked, you know, again, I think this might be a little bit harsh on Daron Harmon, but he hasn't separated himself from the others yet. So I guess you could say I'm a little disappointed that he hasn't owned that position yet.
Yeah, that's a good, valid point. And, you know, we spoke about that last week as well because, you know, I think they're making that position more than any other probably wide open for competition. You know, we've seen Harmon get a lot of reps with the first unit. We've seen Nate Ebner, you know, get reps with the first unit. Patrick Chung, even Tavon Wilson. Tavon Wilson is, you know, pretty much the forgotten man there. Murph, do you have a guy that you feel, you know, you haven't seen or heard stepping up on the defensive side yet?
You know, I don't want to pile on, so I'm going to go back to Brandon Browner. I don't like all of this press that I'm hearing and everything that I'm getting back. There's a difference between being physical at the line of scrimmage and having to be penalized to keep guys in check. And it just seems like every time I'm hearing his name, there's that stigma attached to it that he doesn't look in shape, he doesn't look quick, and he's not handling guys past the that 5-yard, you know, line of demarcation that we give DBs where they can do any damage without grabbing, clutching, and holding. I know he's not going to be here for the first 4 games of the season, but you know, this is the reason when he was brought in was the reason that everybody started to say, look how deep our secondary is. Well, you know, if he's giving up a first down on a holding penalty on, you know, every other play down the field, it's not going to help us. And you guys know I was a big proponent to bring him here too.
Yeah, absolutely, as we all were. And, you know, I think part of that is the fact that we're talking about practice here. You know, we'll see more of that tomorrow night. I think the first unit guys will get a nice look because I think Belichick wants to see how their, you know, I think not only their play on the field, but I think he wants to see their communication, you know, how well they're communicating out there in a game type situation. So we'll see. I'm not really worried about that. You know, we watch Browner. Yeah, and there was a couple of times where he was over the top, especially that one day with Kembrell Tompkins. I'm not really worried about him. We'll see what happens in the game situation, but you know, that other than that really one day with Kembrell Tompkins, I think he's been pretty close to being right on line of what you would want to see in a game. But again, we haven't seen officials on the field yet. Guys, we're going to take a very short break. And when we come back, we'll have Field Yates from ESPN with us.
Football fans, check out the official T-shirt apparel shop for the Pro Football Central Radio Network. Check out bigfrog.com/Cincinnati. That's bigfrog.com/Cincinnati. You think it? We ink it. They have an awesome 24-hour turnaround time.
Your dirty face, hide behind your collar. What is done in vain? Truth is hard to swallow, so you pray to God to justify the way you live a lie, live a lie, live a lie. And you take your return, and you do your crime. Well, you
And welcome back to Patriot Central. We have a very special guest on the line with us right now, Field Yates from ESPN Insiders as well as ESPN Boston. He's a guy that we've had on in the past, and I know I burn up his DM lines on Twitter all the time asking him his opinion on stuff, so we talk all the time. Field, welcome to Patriot Central.
Steve, it's good to be back, and I really appreciate you guys thinking of me. And don't think that I don't appreciate your DM. We always have fun. We always keep it light and always informative as well.
Well, I appreciate that as well, because I feel like I'm monopolizing your time, especially early on Sunday mornings. That's when we're both early risers, so that's when we get a lot of good stuff in there. But I want to jump right in. Before we pass it around to Murph and Russ, I wanted to ask your opinion on something. You know, a lot of the teams release these unofficial depth charts, and, you know, it gives us guys who love to talk about football and write about football things to talk about. Do you put much stock in these unofficial depth charts?
You know, I'm going to defer to Chip Kelly and what he had to say about these. I don't know if you guys saw his quotes, but I imagine you may have. And he basically said, I don't care about these depth charts because they are worth nothing. As a matter of fact, he said his PR guy pulled his depth chart together. And, you know, I think there's just so many moving parts in training camp. You know, what happens if some guy gets injured and, you know, rookies haven't even played a snap right now? Certainly quarterback and some of the other positions are going to keep a close eye on because of the fact it's just one player at that position and he plays the entirety of the game in an ideal situation. But a wide receiver, tight end, even cornerback, you're kind of thinking to yourself, this is as fluid as any other situation in football, so let's not get too bogged down with depth charts this time of the year.
Yeah, that's a good point, too, because, you know, I looked at the Patriots depth chart and it just didn't seem, it seemed kind of like science fiction more than anything else. I mean, they had Brian Stork listed as the fourth center, and I thought that was kind of almost comical.
Yeah. Yeah, rookies take a back seat on the Patriots depth chart. If you're a rookie, I don't care if they drafted Jadeveon Clowney this year and they were slotting him as a defensive end, he'd probably be fifth or sixth string. So that's just another way for Bill Belichick to keep his rookies grounded and humble and not let their heads get big if they were trending that way at all.
All right, I want to switch gears and talk about Rob Gronkowski. And you wrote an interesting column about how Gronkowski's health could actually vault the Patriots' offense, you know, into the possibly the number one offense in the NFL. And we were talking about that same exact topic last week, and we'd like to get your, you know, your feelings on this about how he. You know, how he balances out this offense and how he makes everyone else on the field a little bit better.
Yeah, I have to double check this exact stat. But if I'm not mistaken, the Patriots, during the final eight games that they played during the regular season last year, were the highest scoring offense in the NFL, even above Denver. And, of course, you have some outlier games like the 55-point drubbing against the Pittsburgh Steelers. But the Patriots offense, you know, for most of those eight games, or at least a good chunk of it, had Rob Gronkowski. And I think that you can look at the stats of Gronk and know that he led all tight ends in terms of receiving yards per game. And we know that the red zone offense got dramatically better for the Patriots. I think they, during the six-plus games that Rob Gronkowski played last year, the red zone offense was fifth in terms of touchdown efficiency. And I can, you know, the numbers, they speak for themselves of Rob Gronkowski. I think, though, just sort of thinking about it on a larger scale and maybe a more technical X's and O's scale, really what it does is it forces the defense into a personnel pickle, because if you play your base defense and have a linebacker or a safety covering Rob Gronkowski, there's simply no way to account for him man-to-man. But if you go into your sub-personnel and say, okay, well, we'll try a cornerback on Rob Gronkowski, the Patriots are just going to run all over you. And I always turn back to week four of the 2012 regular season, where the Buffalo Bills played at least 86% of their snaps with three cornerbacks on the field. The Patriots went on to rush for, I think it was 234 yards that game, because Buffalo said, we'll go small, and the Patriots said, fine, we'll just stomp all over you. Rob Gronkowski is, and I know that Jimmy Graham got paid so much money this offseason, deservedly so, but Rob Gronkowski is the biggest difference-making tight end in the NFL, and really, for my money, guys, it's not close.
Wow, that's some telling stuff right there, Field. We'll probably come back to this topic in just a second, but I want to pass you over to Murph, and he has a couple of questions for you as well.
Yeah, Field, it's Murph. Nice to finally meet you. Always great to have a wedland guy on. Wesleyan's a great – I love Wesleyan. Everybody knows I grew up in Middletown, so I'm a big Wesleyan supporter.
Yeah. I've got my Wesleyan football shirt on right now, as a matter of fact.
Hey, bravo. Go Cards. Go Cards. I want to jump on – I want to jump into the backfield field. I want to jump into the backfield. What do you guys think? There's been so much good talk about James White this preseason, and more people harping on Stephen Ridley and four fumbles. It drives me insane. And how the writing's on the wall that this could be it for Ridley, and even his starting job is in jeopardy before the first snap of the season. How do you see things shaking out in the backfield? Is there somebody on the outs? Are we going to go with four running backs? And is Stephen Ridley spot on this team as the starter in trouble?
I don't think that Stephen Ridley's spot on the team is in trouble. I think that there's a chance Stephen Ridley might be, just like he sort of was last year, part of a rotation. I think that Ridley has obvious strengths that no other Patriots running back has. He is their most powerful back, especially now that LeGarrette Blount is gone. He's the best back they have in terms of making defenders miss in the hole. I'm not talking about players in space, because I think we all know that Shane Vereen is extremely elusive and agile and quick. But Stephen really does a great job of picking up yards after contact. But we know the obvious limitation in his game is that he has had ball security issues. I think to address James White, it's sort of a double-edged sword, because a smart, wise scout is that man who can see a football player's talent before others do, and it manifests itself not just in games when you see a guy rush for 200 yards, but you see his practice and you see various intricacies of his game that say, okay, this guy's got a chance to be good. So on the one hand, there's promise from James White based off what we've seen. On the other hand, you think to yourself, he hasn't even played a game yet. So let's not pump the tires too much. I do think the Patriots know that James White is a running back who will impact them not just on the ground, but also catching the football. And by that logic, you wonder if he has some sort of replaceability for Shane Vereen, who will be a free agent after this season. That being said, I think the Patriots would like to keep Shane Vereen long term. I think it's an intriguing backfield. I think ultimately the Patriots, as they've been quietly over the past couple of years, will once again be a top 10 rushing team.
Right. And jumping over to the other great points, jumping over to the other side of the ball, though, when we're getting into sub packages, who is going to be the other defensive end that's on the field?
I think when the Patriots go into their sub-package look, it's really a great question, because they just don't know what kind of workload Vince Wilfork will be capable of this season. And I think that losing Silver Saliga to an injury today, and we don't know the full extent, but he's a player that at times last year played on three downs. You know, the question will be, we know Chandler Jones will be on the field. You imagine Rob Ninkovich will be on the field. Will Will Smith, the veteran they signed this offseason, perhaps he could be on the field in sub-packages? Could Vince Wilfork be on the field for sub-packages? Remember, Tommy Kelly was perhaps their best interior rusher before he got hurt last year. Could he be on the field for sub-packages? And then some of their young players, whether it's Chris Jones or Joe Villano, who perhaps might be sort of borderline roster guys, depending on how they perform the rest of this preseason, and then a draft pick like Zach Moore, and then a second-year player like Michael Buchanan. I think the Patriots, and I don't think there are a lot of weaknesses on this team, but I do think that the pass rush is something to keep an eye on. They had 48 sacks last year, which is the fifth most in the NFL, but I think we know the difference between sack totals and sack totals in timely situations.
Right.
And we all recall the AFC Championship game. The Patriots had no ability to generate pressure against Peyton Manning. I'm not sure there's a player they added this offseason in terms of out of the free agency of the draft, who we can positively say right now is going to immediately and consistently impact their pass rush. Will Smith could, one of their draft picks could, but I don't think that I would mortgage my home to say that those guys will definitely do it.
Fantastic stuff. Russ?
Thanks, Murph. Field, I want to take you back over to the offensive side of the ball, and want to talk about the wide receiver position. I've had these arguments on several occasions regarding the 2007 Patriots offense compared to the 2003 Patriots offense. I prefer the 2003 Patriots offense where Brady would just find the open receiver and not concentrate on the home run hitter such as Randy Moss. I want to ask you, as a former scout, which is more dangerous, finding the open man like they did in 2003 or the high-flying 2007 Patriots offense?
Yeah, that's a great question because I think that obviously both were effective in different ways. I mean, the Patriots were really one drive away from being the greatest team in NFL history, and we would all be saying that's the way that you play offense, the way they did it in 2007. I think that what we saw in 2007, though, towards the end of that season, because as we all know, it wasn't just the Super Bowl where things got close for the Patriots, and of course they lost their only game that year, but down the stretch, even Week 17 against the Giants in the AFC Championship game against San Diego, games for the Patriots later on in that season. And part of the problem was that when you get too reliant on big plays in the passing game and you have chemical imbalance on your offense, it can be a problem. I don't think the Patriots' current mix projects to be one of those two. I think it's probably somewhere in between, which might actually be the happy medium, because
right.
I think that they have potential for explosive plays if Aaron Dobson gets healthy, but right now I don't think we need to set any sort of expectations because he hasn't practiced yet and he's still dealing with that foot issue. I think they might have a little more trouble than the 2000, they're a lot more trouble than the 2007 offense in terms of generating explosive plays, but I think they have more explosive players in the 2003 offense. I also think, as I mentioned earlier, they'll be able to run the ball very capably, provided the offensive line steps up, because you guys know it just like many others do. This offensive line last year, not because they didn't have the players, but for sort of inexplicable reasons, just did not perform up to their standard that we saw during the 2012 season.
Well, listen, I'm glad that you mentioned the offensive line. That's going to lead me to ask you about the center position, which I think is vital. Stork is actually out right now injured. I do hope he returns. What are the chances that he actually wins that position, or maybe even Dan Connolly takes it over? I'm not sold on Ryan Lindell.
Yeah, I don't think I am necessarily after last year either. I think the Patriots are going to have to look at this from a not just an on-field perspective, but perhaps a dollars and cents perspective. And I know these positions are very different, but in some ways it reminds me a little bit of last year and the punter battle, because although Ryan Allen, I don't think, was dramatically better than Zoltán Mezco during the preseason, I think that we know that the price tag was far more favorable in Ryan Allen's favor, and that the Patriots may have said, let's just make this up. If Ryan Allen was an 89 on a 100 scale and Zoltán Mezco was a 91, we can still afford an 89 at $420,000 versus a 91 at $1.5 million. So Ryan Lindell doesn't have to just be better than Brian Stork to cement his roster spot. He's got to be sort of dramatically better because he comes at a higher price tag. He's got, you know, less long-term security because Stork is on a four-year rookie contract. Dan Connolly provides an option for, backup center duty. So I think the Patriots could be staring at a proposition where they keep one or two of Dan Connolly and Ryan Lindell. I don't know that either one of them is a lock right now.
Well, great. Great stuff there, Field. I'll pass you back over to Steve. Thank you.
You bet.
Field, you got time for another question or two?
Please do. Yeah, let's do it.
All right. I wanted to talk about Danny Amendola. I know he didn't start off camp. He didn't have the greatest start to camp this year, and a lot of people were questioning whether or not he would still be on the roster week one. Now, we did see these joint practices with the Redskins. Him and Brandon LaFell kind of turned things on. Do you think that if, Dobson is possibly out that first six weeks with, that foot issue, do you think him and Danny Amendola and Julian Edelman can give the Patriots enough pop in the middle of the field?
What's the expression? Fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice, shame on you. Fool me three times. I don't know how you finish that equation, but I'm an apologist of Danny Amendola because he won that Buffalo game for the Patriots last year, whether or not people want to admit it. And He has been one of the marquee players during each of the past off seasons. His skill set is so unique. It's uncommon, his quickness. He is tough, but he is not fragile, but he is prone to injury. I know it sounds crazy to continue to sing his praises because of what, you know, he's dealt with in terms of injuries over the past few seasons, but I still think that Danny Amendola is a big part of this offense, and I would feel good if Danny Amendola, Julian Edelman, and Brandon LaFell are my top three wide receivers to start the season. I think that LaFell has size, has red zone ability, and I think, of course, you're factoring in Rob Gronkowski, so the pass catchers on the whole are good. I'm an Amendola guy, so if he gets hurt again, I might have to change my ways, but for now, I don't think it's time to give up on Amendola, not by a long shot.
And let's flip over to the defense while we're talking about some different things. You know, the Patriots brought in Revis and Brandon Browner. We've seen a significant change in this secondary. I think, you know, it carries over to the other players on the field. And do you think this, you know, secondary, the way it's constructed right now, will lend itself to being a lot more aggressive once the regular season starts? Obviously, yeah, we won't see a lot of that this week.
Yeah, no question. You know, obviously you have to deal with the 4-game suspension for Brandon Browner. But, you know, guys, I've said this, I've written it, I've talked about it with Mike Reese, who is, as you guys know, the very best reporter, regardless of sport, regardless of team. He just does such a good job. And him and I have talked about this at length. But, you know, Darrelle Revis was perhaps the most underplayed storyline this offseason. I mean, this was a year ago, the Patriots had acquired Darrelle Revis, we would have been talking about it like they acquired the Calvin Johnson of cornerbacks. And yet a year goes by, he plays in Tampa Bay, his production was fine, you know, but really he was sort of, it was a bad team, and there were some questions about the usage there. I think some of those are pretty unfounded personally. I think they still got a lot of value out of him. But Darrelle Revis, if he is healthy, and he is as productive as we've seen him in the past, and I think both of those will end up being the case this year. I mean, we're talking about not just the best cornerback in football potentially, maybe the most valuable defensive player in football, regardless of position. You know, he's 29 years old, recently turned 29, so yes, maybe he's, you know, approaching the midway point of his career, but I think it's just been so underplayed how much he impacts the defense every single week, and how much is going to impact the Patriots defense every single week this year. I think the secondary has a chance to be elite. Darrelle Revis, Devin McCourty are two of the very best at their position, period.
And speaking of Revis, do you see him staying just on one side, or will we see him move around as he has done in the past?
You know, I mean, I tend to think that they'll move him around, especially when they play their matchups. I mean, you know, not to say that him and Aqib Talib are the same exact player, you know, wouldn't you imagine that when the Patriots play the Detroit Lions and Calvin Johnson's on one side of the football, or one side of the line of scrimmage from one play, and then on the other side, I think I'd want Darrelle Revis shadowing him as much as possible. So I think the answer will be that Darrelle Revis will be moved around, just like Aqib Talib was last year. You know, there's certainly a comfort level for Brandon Browner on that right defensive side, but I don't think that he's a player that's limited to that. It's not like a tackle spot where, you know, some left tackles aren't equipped to play right tackle and vice versa. More often it's right tackles aren't equipped to play left tackle. But I don't think there's any reason why the Patriots can't utilize Brandon Browner opposite of Darrelle Revis, regardless of what side Revis needs to be on.
You know, it's amazing, Phil. We've been talking for about 20 minutes now, and we haven't mentioned Tom Brady once. But
you know, why bother with Brady? Isn't he over the hill by now?
Yeah, isn't he that guy that's not a lead anymore? But I found that funny. We've talked about everything. We've gone all around the mulberry bush, and we haven't even mentioned Tom Brady, who's having another strong camp so far this year. But
let's put it this way. Thoughts on Tom Brady are that we better not take him for granted, because we're not talking about one of the best right now. We're talking about one of the best of all time. And Brady's preparation is something that should be appreciated by people in all walks of life, not just football players and football fans. You know, I think it's really neat for us to see someone who approaches their craft in every aspect so diligently. And I think the Patriots, they understand just how fortunate they are to have Tom Brady on their side.
And I think we've reached the perfect spot to end this. Field, I really want to thank you for coming on. We really appreciate your insight, and we hope we can talk to you again real soon.
It is my absolute pleasure, gentlemen. Anytime you need someone to come on, you know I love talking Patriots, so give me a shout. Or a DM on a Sunday morning.
Are you looking for an NFL website that doesn't throw rumors against the wall and hope they stick? Then please go to ProFootballCentral.com for up-to-date news and information. ProFootballCentral.com is back and better than ever. We're dedicated to being your number one NFL fan site, so come check us out at ProFootballCentral.com and experience the difference.
And we're back here at Patriots Central. We just finished a really good interview with Field Yates from ESPN Insider as well as ESPN Boston. And as always, he gave us some really good information. I could talk to Field all the time. And as you guys well know, I've told you both in the past that I burn up his DM lines, especially on Sunday mornings. We have a lot of really good discussion. And as a former scout, I mean, he knows his stuff when he talks about positional play and stuff like that. So I find, you know, talking with him really refreshing and interesting. But guys, you know, the Patriots have their first preseason game of the season tomorrow night at 7:30. Really looking forward to having football back. I stayed up on Sunday night and watched the entire Hall of Fame game. So I want to get each of your thoughts on
this. You watched that entire thing?
I watched the entire thing.
I had to send you a bottle of scotch, man. You watched it all.
Hey, it's football. Football is back, baby, and I was loving it. I'm sitting in my chair on a Sunday night watching football. I was a very happy camper on Sunday evening, even though I was watching guys we probably won't even see, you know, once the season starts. But it was a lot of fun to have football back. Plus, I was on the phone with a good friend of mine who's a diehard Giants fan, so we were texting back and forth through the entire game. Anyway, I want to get both of your guys' feelings on what you want to see out of this game on tomorrow night. And Murph, I'll start with you.
I want to see everybody come out of this game healthy. That's what I want to do. I want to get through the first one healthy. I want to see a good bit of I want the Patriots to show me that there's a playmaker on this team that isn't Rob Gronkowski. I want not somebody who just moves the chains. Field did a great job talking up Edelman and Amendola, but I want to see the playmaker. I want to see the guy there that is going to take the top off of this offense, off of defenses. So somebody else besides Gronk is not the last chain of offense for this team.
Yeah, and I think that's a legitimate concern. I mean, this is something we've talked about a lot, and you know, I agree with you there. I mean, that's one of the things I wanted to see. And you know, we talked about, we know all of these wide receivers they have can make plays. They've made plays.
Yep.
Amendola's made plays on occasion. Tompkins has made plays. Edelman had a fantastic year last year. LaFell has made plays in Carolina. But, you know, our question is, can these guys be difference makers? You know, if Rob Gronkowski isn't in the lineup, which he won't be tomorrow night, and being a difference maker is being a consistent threat, not just
right.
on occasion.
I want that threat on the field while Rob's on the field. I'm not worrying about when he's not there. I just want somebody that's going to be able to do it while Rob is there and healthy, and because that's only going to help Rob actually stay healthy and turn this offense into what Field was talking about earlier, that this could be one of the best offenses in the NFL this year, if not the best.
I couldn't agree more. Russ,
Well, it's interesting because Murph said said a statement that always makes me throw up a little bit in my mouth. So the pulled chicken was coming up a little bit when Murph said, "You know what? I want to see someone who could take the top off of a defense." That's and Murph, I love you. So, I know. But hearing that actually makes me want to regurgitate because I think it's the most
it's a necessity. it's not. I'm not saying let's ignore the open man. That's not where I'm going. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I know, Murph. I know what you're saying. I just have heard it to death. And listen, I actually think Aaron Dobson can be that guy. But you know, he's not out there.
Right.
Can Kimbrel Tompkins get deep? Possibly. Can Julian Edelman go deep? We've already seen he can. Believe it or not, he can. Yep. Dan Amendola can. But I know what you're saying. You want to see someone consistently do it. I don't know if that's what this offense is built to do, but I hear where you're going on that. For me,
I want defenses that are scared of more than Rob Gronkowski and Julian Edelman getting 6 yards. That's what I want.
I hear you, and listen, you bring up a valid point, but my counter to that, Murph, is that the reason why Rob Gronkowski is so valuable and the reason why I don't think the Patriots win a Super Bowl without him is because he makes everyone around him better, like you just said. You want to see someone be a playmaker without him, I'm telling you right now there isn't, and there isn't going to be because he's a unique player. And that's the rub here. He will make everyone around him better, but without him, they're an ordinary offense. That's the reality.
No, that's too bad, because I think with all the draft picks that we've spent over the past few years, that should have been found.
Right.
And it's too bad Aaron Dobson's hurt, and I think I'm with you. I think he can be that kind of guy. But we should have gone out and found somebody else, not named Brandon LaFell. You know, no offense to Field. I'm not a Brandon LaFell fan. I don't think he's a playmaker. I wanted another playmaker on this team. And somebody's got to step up and do it and make them think about it, whether it's Tompkins or someone else. It has to be done.
Okay. Well, let me ask you a question, Murph, because you just mentioned Brandon LaFell. What happens if Brandon LaFell becomes that guy?
Say that one more time, bud.
I don't know. I think things are breaking up a little bit.
Yeah. Well, guys, I know Russ is breaking up a little. The one thing I do want to see here is I want to see the defense step up. And I'm not talking about overloading blitzes and stuff like that because they're not going to do that in preseason. They want to see guys beat their opponent one-on-one. They want to see guys that be, you know, able to function on their own without having to scheme. So we're not going to see that. But I do want to see how Tommy Kelly, you know, Vince Wilfork, Will Smith, how these guys hold up in a game situation now, especially against the run, because that was an issue with them last year. We know the pass defense is going to be better, but I do want to see how they hold up against the run. So that's something I'll be looking for. And again, it's a basic thing, building block. First preseason game, and I do want to see the rookie quarterback. I want to see how he handles things. So, guys, we've reached the end of our show. It's been entertaining, as always, talking with both of you. We had Field Yates on. It was fantastic. And next week, I was wrong last week. I made a mistake. I said Shalice Manson-Young was going to join us. She's actually joining us next week. And I had my dates mixed up. But shoot the messenger on that one, guys. But for myself, Steve Balistrieri, Russ Goldman, Thomas Murphy, thanks for listening to Patriots Central. We'll be back next week with another show.
Well, you can tell everybody. Yeah, you can tell everybody. I'm the man.
You have been listening to an exclusive podcast on the Pro Football Central Radio Network. For news, blogs, and other awesome podcasts, please check out ProFootballCentral.com and follow us on Twitter at PF Central.
Good morning. Let's go. Hello. Come on. Good morning.